My name is Charles Bailey. I work for Bloomberg in the developer experience team, and one of the things we do is support developers in their use of version control and the workflows that they follow using them. And so I have an interest in version control. I'm quite sure where it stands on the cables here. I've got it in front of my computer, but I can't see what the next slide is going to be, so I'll work it out. So yes, I've had an interest in version control for a while, I've kind of been involved in Git quite a bit. Kind of interested in the concepts of distributed version control, and also the kind of history of version control, where it's come from, and kind of what it's leading to. So I'm hoping this talk will be kind of like informal and interesting. I'm not going to show any Git commands, I don't think, unless there's a surprise slide that's like found its way in from a different version or branched in. that could have cherry picked one from another talk, yeah. Or merged on bad. It never happens, does it? So I thought I'd kind of look a bit about what version control's for and what types of version control systems there have been in the world, what the advantages are, and where we're going next. So what is a version control system? My presenter notes are blank, so I'm assuming that I am into this definition. It's a tool to manually manage authored artifacts created in production of software. So if it's not manually created, it shouldn't be in source control. I like to say that a lot. Lots of people on teams I help don't seem to think in quite the same way and have like object files or kind of like other kind of generated artifacts. Documentation is kind of an interesting one. I'm kind of liking documentation a bit like source code, so if it kind of if it gets kind of complex, if it's kind of the build version probably shouldn't be in source control, but maybe the source author version should be. So then, you know, there are other version controls tools and that you can use for kind of binary stuff. I'm kind of really talking about the systems that are used for the source code and other manually authored artifacts. So, what should a version control system provide? So, there's a really good, draft paper that Eric Raymond wrote that's on his website. It's draft, it seems to have kind of like date from 2007 roughly. It would be really great if you kind of did some updates, but I suspect that other stuff is taking its time. So there are kind of like three main kind of aspects to source control systems. So there's reversibility. So that's the ability to get back to a previous state, a previous point in time. So if I write some sort of software module and I build it, run it, and I make some changes, and I want to go back to the initial version, I should be able to kind of go to my source control system and have it help me do that. There's concurrency. So this is the ability to handle more than one person or a person in more than one roles wishing to make a different sort of change at the same time. So there's a lot of talk, there's often a lot of talk, especially at C++ conferences, about concurrency and parallelism. Once people finally agree on the definitions, they often agree about a whole lot of other things. I kind of think of concurrency as the desire to work at the same time, and the parallelism as the actual ability to make simultaneous progress. So with concurrency, an exclusive locking mechanism still enables concurrency, it's not parallelism. Parallelism is like, you know, when everything makes huge amounts of changes, and then when you throw it all together in a merge, it all works. That's probably a bit of a stretch for just the parallelism. And then the final aspect is annotation, the ability to add some metadata to the changes that are being made. So your commit message, the ability to tie that annotation back into history. So blame, which is the other synonym for annotation, isn't it? Okay, so I don't know where source control starts. My research stopped at SCCS. SCCS, I believe, came out of Bell Labs in the 1970s, like all good stuff in software. It's very much file-based, so it operates on a single file at a time, but typically you have like multiple files in the system under control at the same time. It's kind of interesting. It's still around today. The original implementation was in Snowball 4, using the Spitball compiler. There's a really good paper that I'll come up with a quote from later. It's a really good paper by the author in IEEE, where he describes the system and how it's developed and designed the system decisions they made. So it originally ran on an IBM 370 and kind of talks about, you could have used a low-level language. Not C, because like C was probably just around, but a bit too novel and exciting for those days. But apparently it's Bliss or PL370. I guess probably actually Assembler wasn't far off from a reasonable alternative for implementation. So it's kind of quite interesting. Assembler 4 is a kind of an interpreted kind of macro language with kind of lots of macros and stuff. So it's interesting that even then, for something as low level as a version control tool, the performance penalty of a higher level language was actually totally acceptable for the features he was able to develop rapidly. It's still under development today. I believe the version that's kind of under development is part of the Solaris open sourcing pool of stuff. So I think Jörg Schilling is the current maintainer. Originally, if you do some research, it says it uses the Weave storage mechanism, which is a kind of way of storing deltas in a way that makes all of the revisions roughly the same cost to access. But it wasn't always this way. If you look at the original paper, it definitely stored four deltas. So when you stored the original revision of a file, it would be stored pretty much whole, but it was technically a delta from nothing to the new file. And then every time you kind of check in a new revision, what would be recorded is the change required to get to the new revision from the previous revision. So that meant that if you have a lot of revisions, then retrieving the latest revision took some time because you'd have to retrieve the original one and go and apply all of the deltas. So yes, Mark Roshkin. Is the author of the paper and the originator of SCCS, and describes the kind of typical workflow of the developer. So the first step, you kind of check out a working copy, and the second step, you get to edit it. What I find quite interesting is because if you read the paper, it seems like the system is just, it's pretty much designed like a modern control system. It seems to write all the features. One of the big differences is the editing cycle between commits may span several days or several weeks, which to me, and I hope to many of you, is a bit of an anathema. I like to commit most minutes, I think, probably. But yes, so I think one of the reasons that if you kind of look at the performance and the kind of compression ratios, the number of and things, it kind of looks quite similar to today. But the big difference is the number of versions that people typically stored in these things is going to be quite small because they didn't check in too often. Cool. So RCS is probably more widely used than SCCS, even though it's kind of more recent, or perhaps because it's more recent, but probably principally because it's open source and free and available. And in my first job at a web startup, I was using RCS as a production version control system, so I know the appropriate two and three letter commands and four letter words you can use when using RCS. It's in principle very similar. It's file based, so you choose to put a single file under revision control rather than source control, because we've got an R in our subject. The naming sequence for the files containing the deltas. Apparently, SCCS used to use a big prefix in the same directory, and RCS uses a comma V at the end. I think SES has changed the suffix now, and both of them you can now store in a subdirectory. Probably SCCS has been running on systems without subdirectories. It's just kind of I haven't researched that one for definite, but it sounds possible. But having your comma V files in a subdirectory kind of makes a lot of things look a lot neater. Another interesting behavior I kind of find, which kind of comes from these old systems where storage is at a premium, is that the default behavior for these sorts of tools was like, when you check out a file to work on it, you get a working copy, and then when you check it in, the working copy is usually removed so that you weren't kind of wasting space for this kind of stuff that you weren't actively editing. That's kind of also quite interesting. Somewhat different from these days, where we tend to kind of like pull down everything and all history into a separate copy when we want to work on stuff. The joys of cheaper storage. One of the things that RCS is, I put citation in there because it's not quite true. So RCS tends to use a reverse delta, so it stores the latest revision in its entirety, and then stores deltas of how to get back to original versions. This means that the common operation of retrieving the latest version is really cheap, and then if you want to navigate history, it's not too expensive, but it's kind of more expensive. It's not quite true, because if you're on a branch, RCS actually stores the kind of the reverse deltas from the branch point to get to the tip of the branch, and then if the branch that you came off and moves on in history, you end up having to go back from the tip and then turn around and come back to where you are. I think the reasoning being that being on a branch is not as common. Although I've definitely spent some time in some RCS projects where everything was on a branch. Fortunately, I think computers these days are so fast at applying the RCS sorts of patches that you don't generally notice this too much. I think, as I hinted earlier, it was open sourced a lot earlier than SCCS. I believe it started as open source in 1990, and SCCS only got open source in 2006, which is probably about the same time as Git got open sourced. So a year, just after. although Git probably wasn't usable at the same time. Some people might say it's the same thing about SCCS, but anyway. Cool, so RCS and SCCS, file-based. So all the revision numbers kind of based on files. So that means that files that you change often get kind of like big revision numbers, and files you don't get small revision numbers. And if you want to associate, a set of the current version or a particular snapshot of a number of files, you have to go into each one and tag it. A single command will do this to multiple control files, but it has to annotate each file individually. So typically with RCS, you get kind of things that look a bit like this. So, you're on trunk and you've made lots of revisions. Whenever you branch off, you get another two numbers. So the first number is kind of a branch identifier. So in each pair of numbers, the first number is like a branch identifier, and then they've got a kind of revision on top of that. So you always get these kind of pairs of things, and typically it's a very low number, a higher number, a low number, and a high number. I just spent a long time wondering, can I ever get two in here or here? And yes, you can, but normally only when you've made a second branch off the same revision, or you've made a kind of top level new branch. But as I reordered my bullet points. So I said you can assign symbolic names across multiple files, and that's the way you kind of version whole trees. Cool. So this is kind of a state of the art, I guess. I don't know. I'm not that old. I was sort of using 1994, I'm fairly sure it wasn't state of the art then, was state of the art 80s, if you like. And this is the way things work. So one of the big issues is like it's all file based. So there's no way to kind of rename a file. You can kind of like copy the history file into the new name and put some sort of annotation in it. It's kind of really clunky. There's also no native support for working on multiple machines. It's all kind of built around the model that you log into your company's computer and you edit the file that other developers aren't editing, and you check it in and then mark it as no longer group writable until the next person checks it out. It's kind of hard to criticize stuff developed for a mainframe environment for not being distributed, but it's kind of obvious as we enter the era when individual developers have their own machines. It's kind of obvious that we need a big change in the way that version control works. So the next era, heralded by CBS. I like CBS. So we're starting now to move to an era where we have a working copy of a project. So one of the first things you do when you're setting up a CBS environment is play around with your CBS route until you find some modules that you're going to be working on. And then you have a server component. For the first time, a checkout operation is pulling files from one area to another area where you can start working independently, which is awesome. It's really good. So groups of files are now versioned together, however, not atomically. So you can have an operation that works on multiple files, and it can succeed wonderfully. And then you can try a similar sort of operation in the middle of the day. And you can succeed in upgrading some of the files, and then you might hit some conflicts, and your commit fails. And unfortunately, some of your files are committed, and others happen to need resolving, which means that you've got no guarantees that the version on the server at any particular time represents anybody's working tree. It kind of takes a bit of care, or perhaps you say it's not going to scale to too many people throwing stuff into the same repository really quickly. And the other, so I probably didn't emphasize this enough. So previously, all working in the same area, the model has been a lock edit release cycle. So you obtain a lock, and it's your exclusive lock, and you get to use it. You get to edit the file, and then when you're done, you release the lock. And if you go on holiday or you finish work and go for a weekend, and your colleagues need to make changes, they have to break your lock, which there are mechanisms to do, and they can kind of, typically in the RCS world, they have access to your changes because you're using the same server and your edits are kind of lying about. But they can kind of break your lock and then throw away your changes because obviously they're incomplete, and put their own changes in, and then on Monday morning you come in, take an exclusive lock, and delete all of their changes because you're so angry, and kind of lock the thing back in again. So with CBS, as a placating gesture to the days of yesterday, you can lock, but it's like an optional feature. You don't have to lock. CBS now allows a different way of concurrent working, and it now allows you to check stuff out into your working area at the same time as somebody else has checked stuff out into their working area, and to work in parallel, to use a controversial word. And then once you've both finished your edits, you can both commit. And on a good day with the wind behind, both of your changes go in. And if you've edited the same file, one of your changes gets in, and the other of you gets to resolve a conflict. It'll say, I couldn't check this in because it's moved on in version. You need to resolve this conflict with a CVS update. And once you've done that, then you can make a commit. Of course, what can happen is that you have a beautiful working tree, and if you're into tests, maybe all of your tests passed as well. And when you committed, some of those changes, maybe your new tests checked in successfully, but the bit of code that made them passed has hit a conflict and hasn't worked. And then you do an update, and you get some new tests that were committed by the other person, and you also get some of the code that they had to make those tests pass, and you're left in a state that is completely different to how you were before. You were in a kind of like clean, working, everything works state, and now you have like possibly all the tests broken. You know, your tests are broken because you pulled in some code that conflicts, you know, even if it compiled, and their tests break because your changes kind of interfered in that way. And there's no easy way to go back to your clean working copy. So CVS tended to encourage these glorious workflows where a developer working on the grand refactor, so you could put in awesome new features. Would have, like, on Friday, when you check in, or alternatively, additionally, do things like zipping up their entire working copy just in case the CVS update causes something so intractably bad you can't recover from it. And if they did, you'd be like, okay, I'm going to revert the entire repository to the version I was working on, check in my changes, and then, you know, force you to go and do your own stuff. It's kind of kind of slightly horrible. And this state that you can get in where you can't, with the tool, record your clean, happy version before getting your stuff recorded on the server. That's an issue that that we'll come back to later. So the implementation of CVS, basically it uses RCS under the hood to manage the individual files. And so the files are still versioned individually, it's just that we've built some whole tree operations on top. As I said, kind of merging requires some discipline and care. So, famously, to address some of the issues, so there are kind of like other issues with CVS. So, renames. CVS is kind of quite, so it's quite happy for you to rename the file. You just delete the file with the old name and you add it with the new name. But people tend to get unhappy that when they kind of logged individual files, the history would stop at some point. And you'd have to know, maybe by looking at the last commit message, if it had been done correctly, that this is actually a follow-on for a previous file. And then you could, you know, it's perfectly possible to go and have a look at the log for this file that no longer exists. It would go into an area that CVS likes to call the attic. And so you delve into the attic and then you can see the whole history. In order to address this kind of usability concern, it's very common for CVS admins to go into the attic and move around the RCS files so that it looks like a renamed file has got a continuous history before the rename. However, if you do this, it's now impossible to recover an accurate tree of anything that's before the rename, because you go and check out, something with a label that was before the rename, and the file will actually check out with a new name in a place that it never really actually existed. So that was kind of horrible. So to address sort of some of these concerns, a new glorious version control system decided to do CVS done right, famously, or infamously, perhaps. So one of the fun things with CVS is that you still have the kind of RCS style kind of versioning under the hood with the branches with lots of kind of pairs of numbers. And if you were very disciplined, you could do kind of regular integration merges between, say, a developed branch and a master branch. But it kind of required you to be quite disciplined and to explicitly know what you'd merged in before. And so you use the CVS update command with two minus J's on kind of regular basis, quite carefully, and you could do this. But it did require you to be very disciplined. If you kind of got the wrong label, something you'd already integrated before, you tend to end up with these sort of spurious merge conflicts, and it kind of told the expert it's time to back out now and do something else. It told the almost expert to just really try harder and someday I'll be able to commit, and sometimes it would actually be the right answer. So CVS tried to make the branching model much simpler, and so instead of having branches as like alternate versions, subversion basically just encouraged the standard layout, and branches and tags just became copies of the main, which is the trunk, or copies of other branches at a certain time. And so it's kind of like, it's a very easy UI to look at, provided that you follow the recommended conventions. But personally, I kind of felt they lost something by not modeling a branch as an explicit concept. Subversion took quite a long time to get what they call proper merge tracking. So if I, what have I merged in before? Which paths have been merged in? Now, kind of arguably, it's got. Can I say better merge tracking than Git? It's got a different merge tracking than Git. So you can, because everything's like a subfolder, Subversion actually has to kind of track which paths have been kind of merged in. So in Subversion, it's actually possible to merge the subtree of a branch into another branch, and then merge maybe the rest of the branch at some time later. And the merge tracking kind of works because it's had to track the files. I have to confess I haven't actually done this in practice. I think it probably requires a lot of care to know what you're doing. But it is, I find it interesting to just kind of like challenge the assumption that that Git's always right and that anything else is wrong. It's my immediate reaction, but it's not always true. In tools like Git, where you've got kind of whole trees and your commit graph is all about the root tree, either you've merged two commits together in their entirety, or you haven't. And some of the kind of issues that people have is, especially if you kind of want to, if you've made a commit and you want to kind of revert it on a branch as it shouldn't have quite been in there, you can do a different sort of merge. You can do I throw away this merge and then I actually keep a change sort of merge, and they're represented in exactly the same way in Git. I'm actually quite interested in the modern merge tracking that Subversion provides. Cool. If anybody has any questions, do kind of or things that they think I should have talked about, then feel free to shout out. I know it's early in the morning, and thank you for all coming. Seems like quite a big audience for this time of the morning.
Is that it? The tracking that you're talking about, does that mean that if you just copy a file, so you've got two copies, can you then sort of merge between them?
I believe it does, and I have to say I don't spend much of my energy on seeing how well Subversion is at the moment, but yeah, Subversion kind of, if you do a copy, it knows where it's come from, so in theory that should work. And it's kind of quite interesting what in theory you should do, and because one of the things that people do sometimes ask for in Git is that I'd like to be able to do this merge. I've done some of the conflict resolution, but I'd like to do the rest of it later, and it's kind of like, well, you know, you can make a temporary commit, but you know, I wouldn't push that anywhere because it's not an accurate representation. I need to kind of fix it up later. So yeah. Merge tracking's been in there since 1.5, but I think it's had improvements recently. Yes?
So one thing you can do with Subversion is sometimes if you're in a release branch, you just want to record the fact that you've reconciled all the changes you've done, so you can just record the merge. And without actually doing any stuff, which is something I don't think we do in Git. So it's just a logical thing that says, you know, I've closed the loop, feedback loop, if you like.
Yeah, I mean, you can make a commit in Git where you resolve it in a different way, like ignore all the changes over there, and then you kind of, the next time you merge in, it'll only look at the stuff since then. So you can do something similar, but yeah. Okay, yeah, thank you. Yes?
You said not to... not to store final binaries in the version control system. I actually take the opposite approach. I always store the final binaries because disk space is cheap now. And also I worry that if I only store the original source code, that I won't be able to recreate those binaries because Windows Update will have updated various DLLs and things on my machine, various other tools and things have changed.
Yes.
So I wonder why. So
I would absolutely archive your important binaries, definitely do that. I would think carefully about using a source control tool to do that, and some source control tools are good for archiving binaries. What I recommend against, or what I most strongly recommend against, is storing both the source and an output of an operation in the same source repository. And the reason I do that is it's just open to confusion. It's just too easy to go, I'm updating some source, and now I've got something that's inconsistent, and it's sometimes not obvious when you've chosen to regenerate the output. Bloomberg use a different system for storing, for archiving binaries than we do for the source of them. And that's kind of what I recommend. But yeah, sure, some binaries, so with reasonable size binaries, you can store them in Git. But what I would typically recommend is you have a source control for your source here, and then when you do a build, you archive the artifacts in a different system.
Yeah, I just store them in the same repository.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend that, but I'm, you know, if it works and you've got a system that doesn't lead to any issues, then go ahead, go right ahead. Yes.
So just to follow up on that, I think the actual issue you have there is to store the configuration information, which is the challenge, the whole setup and the source, and that's.
But a lot of that is just like random Windows DLLs in there, the challenge. So you want to try and store, have a snapshot of everything you deliver to the customer, not just the stuff you generate from the source code.
The more you can head down that route, the better. The two truths thing of the.
Yes. So there's another aspect to that, which is, it's like you've got the output and you've got the input, and then you've got the environment that you need to add to the input to get to the output. And that environment can get very big. So, ultimately, it could be an entire Windows VM snapshot with all network devices deleted so that it doesn't do any random updates when you bring it up. Because one of the things you want to do is to say, or you might not say, and it depends on the environment you're in, and certainly in some more safety critical things, it gets more and more important. It's like if you determine there's a bug in this particular version that somebody has, you want to fix just that bug. So you want the exact environment you used originally to build the original, and just make that one change. What you normally don't want to do is just pick up every Windows update in the past 2 years and build that again. And that's kind of like an entire separate challenge, and it's kind of probably the topic of a completely unrelated talk.
Yeah, I don't go that far. I'm trying to sort of.
Yeah, there's a cost value thing. So I went to Mike Long's Docker training, a pre-conference tutorial, and that's kind of really interesting for some environments. It seems to be a way where you can, at least kind of relatively cheaply in an organized way, kind of have, you know, a build environment as a container, your source control and the output, so you can kind of go back and reproduce it. But then you can also update your the container that you used to build for a more modern compiler and take, you know, the same version of the source and kind of see the difference. So yeah, I guess this is the whole conversation that source control is but a small part of configuration management and application lifecycle processing and other TLAs that I tend to run streaming away from, like, a bit too much of. But yeah, no, certainly if you're managing your own child software lifecycle, it's something you should consider how heavily you want to kind of go down these routes. Yes?
I kind of think putting binaries in under source control, it smells a little bit to me. We're being encouraged to do some sort of work for a continuous integration environment so that the build will have everything necessary to do with the third party libraries. That's what I've already talked about. So it's just that with everything from source control. It's able to build with everything centralized structure, including the third party libraries. Do you think that smells a bit, or do you think that there's better ways to get the third party libraries onto the continuous integration program?
So, yeah, I think it smells a little bit, but yeah, I mean, to be fair, if you have, there's an obvious attraction to having everything you need in the same source control repositories. You just do one checkout, everything's there, you know it's there, and you can build from there. It's just that when your application grows to any size, when you get a number of kind of build environment changes, you tend to lose the performance of most source control tools. You tend to kind of build up a big database. So if you can kind of like bite the bullet and kind of like come up with an environment where you've got something something like a binary artifact repository and a configuration file that tells you which ones to pull, you can end up with a system that's kind of slicker, and you've still got a source control repository that's kind of lean, mean, and easy to use, and just has the changes that are relevant to that, to the source there. So I kind of tend to kind of lean towards a kind of more modular approach here, if you can choose to set up the environment. That's kind of why I'm quite interested in Docker, because it kind of seems to be one possible solution if it kind of fits what you're doing in other ways. Yeah, certainly, definitely found the Windows environment with its kind of like, you need a raft of patches before you're safe in the world, kind of it's very difficult to kind of go back to how an XP3 machine was in 2007 when I built, you know, whatever it was. XP3 dates 2007, doesn't it? But yeah, because, you know, your Visual Studio got updated to Service Pack 4 and then these hotfixes went on top, the environment is kind of very difficult to track. With many Linuxes, it's kind of a lot easier because, depending, you know, so long as you keep your build machine sufficiently controlled, you can normally get the package manager to kind of dump, you know, exact versions of all the packages, and then you can kind of keep that in a repository to recreate a bit more easily. It's kind of like with Windows one, it's almost like you have to have a virtual machine and kind of like snapshot it and just have this massive kind of binary of like, well, here's a state that worked once and let's boot it up, not connect to the internet. Cool, so subversion. So we're now seeing concurrent systems, client-server model, and people are submitting useful, I do like this paper as well, some lovely quotes. It shows that many of the issues with source control have been around pretty much since manual source control. And I think this probably still holds true today. It's another bug, I'll try it again, or more fix-ups normally should be right this time. These days, we can write much better commit messages because storage is cheap. Here is an example commit message from from Git's Git repository. As you can read here, it was committed by junior maintainer, and explains all of the maths behind the algorithm change that went into the diff. Here's some of the, this is a close-up of the previous slide. So obviously this like helps anybody kind of know exactly the rationale behind the change. I'm actually not much of a fave, I'm not a fan of this sort of commit message. I kind of think that this paper probably belongs in tree and as a design document, and then the commit message says, you know, re-engineer diff to deal with these things, add in all the details in the design document, then you can go and read it, because, I mean, to be honest, reading this out of the commit log is not the easiest. And if you're using commit log for other reasons, just do the history of the file, having about 5 screen pages to scroll down before you hit the next commit that you might have been interested in is not particularly useful. Cool, so that's more modern commit messages, that's better than being tried again. Concurrency models. So I've kind of touched on this a bit. In fact, I think I meant to have this slide a little earlier. So originally when we were on our kind of mainframe with SCCS, we had locking, because that's pretty much the only sane way to do stuff when you're all on the same machine. I can't believe I used to work like that in 1994. I mean, I did have my own PC, but to do our web page updates, we did log into the Vir server and edit the same files. We had written our own web server as well at that point, which turned into Apache module at the time. And then with CBS and Subversion, we have a new model that people can work at the same time, but we very much have a merge before commit. So I've made a massive refactor, you changed the variable name, Fred's added a new feature which is like cause an extra parameter to be added to like 14 different files. Come on, we're in the real world, we haven't quite isolated our roles and actors and things. I want to commit, and if I haven't got in there first, I hit the dirty tree problem. I have to kind of resolve everything before I make a commit that's kind of recorded what I've done on the server, which leads to the zipping up my working copy for safety mechanism. So now, what I think is probably one of the most important and exciting changes to version control is the commit before merge model, where I can make a commit, a first-class citizen commit, of my changes before I attempt to do an entirely separate activity of merging it in with other people's stuff. I don't see any reason why my making forward progress on the code base, that shouldn't be part of the same activity as integrating with other people's stuff. So this is the distributed version control revolution, if you like, or one aspect of it. It's hard to imagine a distributed version control system that doesn't allow you to commit before merge. I've tried a few times, and it strikes me as the sort of thing you could only really do if you had a glorious centralized version control system and you were trying to hack distributed features on it at the end. Maybe you'd come up with something, but it would be awfully clunky, I think. So yes, distributed version control. I can remember that my good friend Andy Balin, his talk is here, it's 11:30, so it's going to be really good, first actually introduced me to the idea of distributed version control. And I said, well, that sounds a bit nuts. I mean, how do you ever know what the current version truly is? I mean, that's just like, that's insane, it's never going to work. And now I have like 46 commits in the Git repository, and I teach other people to use distributed version control systems, and I back mount centralized systems, probably more than I should. And it's true that almost everybody who uses a distributed version control system has some canonical central repository that they consider to be somehow important. So most organizations have some server looked after by an expert team of server feeders to make sure it's happy and well-fed, where the corporate source code is kept and backup strategies are in place. I'm part of that team, although in our organization, Tony Palmer, a really big team, you know, it's, you know, we've got layers of stuff, we've got kind of file systems and storage networks and server admins, and then people who kind of manage another layer of a specific infrastructure, and then there's us, who are supposed to be experts on the application layer, as they call it, which is like the workings of the Git server. And so we have one, well, we have two central places where people are still kind of migrating to our new central place, but you know, essentially we have a central place we consider the truth. Obviously out there with open source projects, that's totally different, because like every open source project, you've just got individual developers, repositories, and a big network. No, rubbish, everybody uses GitHub, or the people who really hate GitHub have something else, like, you know, kernel.org, it's like we're in control of it most of the time, yes. It's not a safe world out there on the internet, but people still rely on kind of central areas. So the distributed version of control revolution, it's not about removing that central point of communication in practice. It's much more, I think, about the distributed nature, the fact that I can commit and then choose to publish. I can commit before I merge. My stuff can be integrated somewhere else. And that just enables a workflow that is so much easier for so many different scenarios. So yes, DBCS, is it decentralized or is it distributed? And I very much think it's the distributed nature. Still, almost everybody kind of seems to need a central point of reference. And I think I've just waffled over the things that I was going to talk about. So yes, so the operations that typically have been kind of done by servers, so your CVS server kind of goes into all the comma V files and adds your new label that you requested. Now that sort of stuff happens on the client, and then there's a separate step of distributing the commits or the tag operation that you just performed. What does it mean to be distributed? I think I've just talked over like I haven't quite. I guess I put a different emphasis on my slide. Sorry, I've got kind of detached from my slides. So I can do all of these server-side operations and the artifacts that I create, so like the commit log or the tag object or objects, they're made locally and they don't change when I push them to a server. So when I make a tag, and then I decide I've done it wrong and I kind of delete the tag locally and erase it from the world, and I create it again and now I'm happy with it. Right, that tag object, now I'm happy with it. It doesn't change when I distributed it to my central point of reference, or perhaps just to a friend, and he says, yep, yeah, that's good, let's publish it. Okay, we push it onto the central server. It doesn't change. It's not like the server adds its own timestamp or something. I mean, it might add something into a log, but that artifact that I've created, any node in the distributed network can create, you know, the same sort of objects. That's actually quite interesting, because one thing that we do in Git a lot is we make a commit object and we record the author's email address and the committer's email address. Nothing stops another node in the network, a poison node, just making a commit with my email address and a name, attaching it to an obviously inferior commit. I guess one of the interesting points is that to stop something like that getting to our common point of reference, you know, we do still need to be very careful about our access control and who we trust. And this is why the Git maintainer is very cautious about what access to GitHub, and this is just a mirror of Git. It's things like, you know, continuous deployment bots have, you know, it's sometimes nice to have a bot update a branch, you know, last known good build or something. But you know, some care has to be made that that you don't introduce holes where kind of poisoned objects can kind of get into the network in a trusted area. So that's kind of I think that's something that I'm kind of quite interested in, perhaps doing some more research about. And I know kind of there have been kind of conversations about this. Cool. So I mentioned a draft paper that Eric Raymond has worked on. One of the things, slight irritations, is that a couple of URLs that have gone out of date. I was going to suggest a patch to update this. Unfortunately, one of the URLs is the link to the Mercurial repository where this draft is supposed to be hosted, so that was very difficult to do. Anyway, one of the things that he says in his draft paper is that version control above all other areas of engineering, maybe I exaggerate a little, has been hampered by the belief in myths that are false. So the first myth that has hampered source control is that conflict resolution is inherently difficult. And I did a talk last year called How to Merge, which is obviously like 80 minutes of scaring people into how difficult it really is. But it's true. In most instances, while a version control system doesn't replace communicating with members of the same team working on the same project, most conflict resolutions are not that difficult, and kernel development relies on this, and Git is kind of built on the fact that conflict resolution or merging is relatively easy, and conflict resolution is something that is not going to be intractably difficult. This is a more controversial one. So typically, this is the rename problem. You can represent a history of a project in one of two ways. You can represent it as a graph of snapshots. So you can take a snapshot of an internal file system, and then when you make a new commit, you take a snapshot of the file system again. And this is the Git model. And what this means is that things like rename detection, or perhaps function move detection, so if you move a function from one source file to another, these are things that are inferred after the fact by comparing snapshots. Another model is to actually model changes. So you can record, instead of recording a second snapshot when you make a change, you record the actual changes. And the point of this is there isn't actually an exact mapping. So if I delete a file, and then I create a new file with the same content but a different name, that's a different operation from renaming the file. Maybe it doesn't matter so much in that case. But things can get a little more complex. So I can take a file, take half of its contents and split it into a different file. And this is not unusual. And then I could take that original file and I could rename it as like foo-base.cpp or something. So now I have two files, and previously I had one, and I can record this in a huge number of different ways. I can say I renamed it and then I copied it. I copied it twice and then I deleted it. I deleted it and I created new files that have no relevance to each other. It's, you know, if you're doing after-the-fact detection, you may end up picking one of these. You may end up picking one that's least helpful. And sometimes it's kind of useful to actually, you know, put some guidance on which one you actually meant. So, I'm not, to be honest, I'm not quite sure what the again, the practical implications of holding on to this myth is. And I think it's probably a myth that Git is probably a little guilty of ignoring this topic. So it'll be interesting to see. So there are some other interesting version control systems. So Darks in particular had a patch set algebra feature, which sounds kind of quite interesting, but I gather in practice it was not used a lot or not used heavily. And I think one of the things I've kind of discovered is that so there's actually, in Eric Rowan's papers, he's actually recorded a very interesting IRC conversation between the monotone developers and himself. And one of the conclusions they kind of come up with is kind of like, while there's kind of lots of kind of interesting theory about, you know, optimal ways to perform merges, it seems to be that in practice, many developers prefer something simple and naive that they can understand what it's been trying to do and help to fix up afterwards. After all, source control is very much a human artifact, and I think often our source code is kind of quite arty, and to try and kind of like infer an algebra of changes in something that humans have done may well be futile. Cool. So I talked a bit about commit before merge, which I think is kind of key. So where did this come from? So it has to be said that distributed version control owes a lot to BitKeeper. So BitKeeper, I believe, came out of Sun, the software company, not the kind of large fusion reactor that keeps us warm. It was Larry McElroy, wasn't it, who's the author. He actually worked on a closed source version control system before, and he had an ambition. He had an ambition to create a version control system that would support the Linux kernel use case. And I believe he wanted to use this basically as kind of research and marketing, and to be able to kind of sell BitKeeper to organizations who wanted to use it. And due to, you know, human interaction and the vagaries of history, there was an incident where a kernel developer reverse engineered BitKeeper in violation of the agreement. BitKeeper pulled the plug on Linux kernel using it, and now we have Git. And I did a bit of research on this, and apparently reverse engineering involved telnetting to the server on the port on which BitKeeper was running, seeing that it gave it like an ASCII prompt, and then typing the command help, and that was the way in. So what kind of other systems? And many of Arch, which I haven't used. Apparently it was pioneering but not obtuse, but it did kind of influence Bazaar quite heavily. Monotones are kind of a really interesting one. It's kind of, they were very big on security, so signing every change. According to the monotone developers, the BitKeeper fiasco came at a particularly bad time. So one of the developers happened to be moving house or something at the time, and they're just kind of taking the lid off the source code to do some really big poking around. So we're in pretty much no position to respond to kind of some of the performance issues. It's arguable whether kind of more responsively they would have kind of been able to kind of come up with something that worked fast enough, soon enough. Linus Torvalds having something of an urgent requirement. Of course, Git came around at a similar sort of time, or kind of like after monotone, but kind of a similar sort of era. Curiel, obviously, very popular. I kind of mentioned Bazaar in passing. I guess that was an attempt to be kind of like be really easy to use. I think support for that has practically ended. I mean, you can still get it, but I don't think there are any kind of active changes to it. I guess pretty much every source control tool that I know of is self-hosting. That probably represents the death of your source control tool if you kind of like archive to GitHub and you're not Git, but you know. I think this slide might be out of order. Oh no, right, yes. So one of the interesting artifacts of distributed tools, of course, is that there are no global version numbers anymore, because two people can build on top of version one at the same time. And there's no requirement to communicate. So who claims version two? Typically all of the distributed version control systems, you reference the commit from which you made the commit, and commit spawn some sort of graph. And most of the kind of the big changes come from like how we manage these graphs, the kind of the objects we build around them. Do branches have a strong identity? For which the answer is, in fact, I think I'd like to do maybe a lightning talk of what are the good attributes of version controls? You know, should branches have strong identity? You know, should you sign every commit? And we can see kind of like who wins that in a commit off. So pretty much, you know, logically, commits always form some sort of a graph. My slides have come really out of order now. So one aspect that I kind of really like about the commit before merge is it acknowledges a truth that if you can using a really old-fashioned system tends to ignore, and that is that everybody branches all the time. So as soon as you leave the mainframe environment and go into client-server argument, as soon as anybody makes an edit to their working copy, they have effectively branched. And you can kind of try and ignore this fact, but then you end up with CBS. This is an aspect that I do particularly like. It kind of, when you're using it, your local master is a separate branch, and it's all about kind of communicating your changes. So in the distributed world, you know, magic is expected because we've acknowledged that you branch all the time with making a local branch. So we can expect to merge, and we want it to be cheap. So I think I'm pretty much in summary here, although I have two slides after this, so I can't remember which one that is. So there are a lot of kind of advantages. You've got your whole history locally. With the version, I think you have the version that you're working on, so that diff is really cheap. But with things like Git, pretty much all of your inspection artifacts are kind of really cheap. There's no need to make a big distinction between a contributor and somebody with commit access. So that can be a political question, more human interaction, more time wasted that could be spent usefully developing stuff or arguing about design features. It doesn't solve all of the communication problems, but it does mean that you can accept some really good quality patches from a developer that you maybe get on so much, you might not trust them with kind of approving other people's stuff. You know, but there's no reason that he can't make a good sequence of stuff that you're happy to accept in. And the other great thing about kind of working locally and having your local branch acknowledged as a true branch is it takes away a whole lot of decisions that you sometimes have to make into these centralized world. You can make these decisions a lot later. Typically in the centralized world, it's kind of like, should we make a branch for this? I don't know. Like, hang on, stop working. Don't you commit yet, because we need to decide whether to make a branch. Whereas With a distributed version control system, you can kind of like start working, and go, well, actually, I think we should have branched that stable release that we made on Monday. Not a problem. We've got the commit. I can make a branch from the stable release we made on Monday. Or the stuff that me and Fred are working on, we can put that on a separate branch. And I think this is kind of really great. You can kind of get on with stuff, and your version control system can stay out of your way until you need it. So an awesome quote. So one of the things that I kind of touched on earlier is it's kind of quite interesting to look back at history. So looking at a particular project under source control system, source control with SCCS, it's really great how the compression works. So they've got a large number of lines of modules, and the additional space of keeping the entire history was just like 37% more. And typically, that's a very similar ratio to actually get with Git. It's like, you know, that wouldn't be unexpected to have to do a Git clone. If you check out the source tree, I've seen numbers of about 40% of the size of the working tree being the .git repository. So maybe something's never changed. I hope that actually, because people of writing larger systems and more complex code, that actually Git may have made some progress since the forward delta days of SCCS. But you know, you can't take these things for granted. So, it's certainly true that source control systems have a much more complex set of commands these days. It's interesting to note that SCCS only had very few commands. The command to get a working copy was get, and now we've got git. So that's a kind of nice circle of life. Distributed version control systems also have a much richer set of possible workflows. It's also very possible to choose something either explicitly or implicitly, because you can do so many things and you haven't worked out exactly what you're going to do, a workflow that's overly complex. So that was it. And I apologize for my slight dying off there. I didn't quite remember what all of my slides came in. But I hope that's kind of been interesting and kind of questioned some of the stuff that we have available to us these days. And I think one of the most interesting points is the fact is these myths that have held source control back. And one of the questions that Eric Raymond poses, and I'd like to kind of pose now, is what are the myths of source controls that we hold on to now today that we don't realize are myths that are holding us back from working in a better way? What are they? No one. That was a rhetorical question, I suppose.
So,
Well, I mean, to be fair, my talk was about source control systems.
Perforce.
Perforce is a great centralized version of the system, and I'm really interested to see what Perforce are doing at the moment, because if you look at the Perforce homepage, it's basically covered in references to Git. I don't use Perforce, so I'm not familiar with the integration work they're doing, but I know they're kind of like supporting developers who are familiar with Git in some ways, but that doesn't seem really interesting. And the name of their recent conference was called Merge, which is very confusing when I search for the Git Merge conference.
And also, do you know where your case is in this text? Is it dead or?
Sorry, I think it's in clear case.
sorry, I didn't mean to.
Gosh. Yes, I've used clear case before. It's got some interesting artifacts. So you have a specific question about?
Yeah, I'm just curious if it's alive.
Oh, it's very alive. It's very alive. in some environments. I think the way IBM are pushing it is certainly the integration with their task and issue tracking tools, so ClearCase and ClearQuest. And I think it has various certifications, so if you're in a world that likes a lot of traceability and change control boards and things like that, then ClearCase may be for you. But yes, I'm not a fan.
So one of the concerns that we had is the size of the group is getting really large for the code base isn't simplifying that.
Mm-hmm.
So whereas we think we'd be using Purple, so that's pulling down and making changes is when putting down whole repos all the time, it comes to a point when that gets to a certain size that starts to get unusable. So and that's becoming complexity of an issue, but I don't know whether that's real or not, but it's just
I think that is an issue.
Like balance between the two systems.
So yeah. So I think that is an issue and my favourite Git repository is are the ones that stay relatively small and focused. So this is why I'm keeping the output and the input in the same repository. I think it's quite a good idea when you start, if you're doing a grand rewrite and you start V2, start a new repository. It's easier to have a repository that's built on a previous repository and put a temporary replacement ref in to stitch it together when you need to do some analysis. Than it is to have a big repo and try and make it performant. Obviously, my talk on Thursday was all about kind of refactoring repos that we've got out of hand and try and get some lean ones out of that, but that's obviously kind of disruptive to anybody who just wants to kind of do an update. Yeah, it's definitely an issue, and the ease in which the people generate gigabytes of output and can just like add them to a repository. It took them a few minutes to do the push, but hey, that's over, and now everybody suffers the performance every time. It's.
So that's why we're not trying to bind these into working out.
Git in particular has an issue that the initial clone would want to get everything, and so that's why we have kind of solutions like Git LFS to that sort of issue, which is. I think that sort of thing to be more core to Git, but it's actually quite an interesting problem. If you change, so GitFS works, we've got a central server and a kind of associated storage. If you change the model where I can clone, and now I've got a complete copy so I can get rid of this and I can clone again, and that's kind of a safe way to move around. If you change it so that you don't get everything at first, you kind of change that model, and in some ways you almost need to mandate a server at that point. And that's kind of like, that's the question that the Git, just the raw tool, doesn't try to answer at the moment. Something like a LFS that kind of doesn't need to get everything straight away necessarily is kind of quite interesting. Yes?
And just another question back. When the binary was first added, you had to wait a few minutes for the push and then you think the problem is gone. Well, for the people who have an existing repo or a pull from that, they will get a few minutes away from that first pull to get that change. And of course, anybody after that doing an initial clone. But then again, you could ask the question, why are people doing initial clones all the time? If you have a developer set who are working on a repo, they do the pull, and yes, they get the binary artifact, and it takes a little time to do the pull, but if they just keep working that repo, if they do subsequent pulls of small source changes, those are not penalized by that previous binary. So I don't think that just adding a binary in itself makes Git unusable or unusable. So it's connected to how you the practices, the workflows around this. Do you actually need to make initial clones all the time, for example?
It's a fair point. Although I'm quite excited by sort of Docker-based workflows that are often building brand new environments. So I think initial clones are becoming more popular actually, which they can definitely be an issue. From the back.
So I suppose doing around things like MX and LFS and the work that's based with the dumb materials, it's actually creating a new myth, which is that everybody always has a copy of the repo and therefore we don't have to have backups. And that would then, because actually no, it would turn out all of a sudden nobody has it because everybody's only pulled the metadata and not the whole thing.
Yeah.
You're back to a central model because there has to be now has to be one canonical source, and we've just gone back to
Yes. So I mean the thing about the most LFS implementations is that they do break the distributed nature. Yes.
What do you think is the next big thing with this dimensions? Revolution.
I have no idea because I still haven't worked out what the myths are we're holding on to. Maybe the myth is that that Git seems to have won the greatest mindshare, but it's still any good. And you know, Git has huge usability issues for new users, but for backwards compatibility, we need to keep most of the commands the same. So I can definitely see that maybe the biggest myth is that the best way to interact with your source control system is through the command line, because that's certainly a myth that Git perpetuated. Now there are visual tools to help you, but if you talk to most people, it's kind of like the command line is king. And I'm a command line is king sort of person myself, but maybe that's a myth. Maybe the next generation of geniuses will produce something that they put on the helmet and they interact with the version control in a way that I can't possibly imagine. Maybe they have another dimensions, they have branches on 2D and then something else further back, and they're just kind of merging functions around. But who knows? Maybe it's something like that's the myth. Maybe it's the interface that's the myth. I think that's what could be most likely. Yeah, I mean, Git's kind of tree-based, but it is actually kind of strongly file-based. But
more fine-grained.
Functions, yeah. I think, probably one interesting thing is like integrating your programming language with your source control tool so that you're tracking functions and where you keep them. I mean, some languages, your class is determined by where you keep it. But, yes?
So I wonder if you could give any insight to what's happening in the Git community versus when it comes to looking at subtrees and submodules. Is there going to be some point where one or the other becomes the standard way to gather multiple people together, or where's the community heading with this?
That's a good question. So I was in Git Merge, and there's it's kind of recognized in the developer summit that there's kind of pain with both. And yes, I think it's a hard problem. So submodules are kind of core to Git, and the subtree command, which is kind of like just a way of pulling stuff into a Git repository, so it doesn't add anything to the object model. That's just contrib at the moment. So a couple of people have come in working to improve that. Yes, I can't give much insight because I do know that the kind of usability concerns are recognized as kind of real concerns. And so I think probably submodules are going to be improved. It may be that the kind of subtree approach has got a natural limitation because it doesn't add metadata in any way to either repository. My feeling is it might be the limit of its usability just from a standpoint, or at least it's not at its limit, but there is a limit that it can't go beyond. So it might be that the submodule approach is the one that's going to be kind of developed most. At the same time, the submodule thing where in order to collect submodules together, you make a top-level commit in an owning project, that does mean that top-level project necessarily gets a commit any time a submodule changes state. That's not necessarily a workflow that kind of suits all super projects. So I'm kind of quite in favor of where possible kind of loosely coupled repositories. And at that point, it's kind of like maybe there's another tool that manages things, manages the configuration in a separate repository is more appropriate. I'm not Yeah. Anyway, that was my random thought, so sorry it wasn't much of an insight. Yes.
Yeah, I don't know if it's much of a myth, but at least it seems like in Git, it's at least changed. Well, I'm trying to get used to the thing where also you talk about rewrite writing history. I mean, they usually at least have an idea that there was one unchanging history unless you messed with the attic or whatever.
Mm.
But it seems like most people I hear talk about Git in some ways recommend to at least some degree that you rewrite your history at least before committing to a central repository or like you showed actually rewriting the history of the repository. I don't know, maybe it's just something you have to get used to, but I think I find that's different than what I'm used to.
Yeah, so I wouldn't ever recommend that rewriting the whole of history should be a common thing, but at the same time, a working Git repository is, you know, it's a working artifact that needs to service the needs of the developers that are using it. So if it's not performant, you need to kind of change something, and that might involve rewriting history. I'm definitely a proponent of making local commits and then making new local commits that are better, that do the same thing. So coming up with the perfect patch series before, you know, coming up with a semi-perfect patch series that you send for review and then coming up with the perfect one that you're ready to integrate, because this makes, you know, as long as you don't need that in the central repository straight away, you know, the cleaner your commits are, the more useful your repository will be for analyzing change. So your Git repository is doing two things. It's kind of like so that it's enabling the concurrency annotation, but it's also so back to the first slide, the reversion aspect, being able to retrieve the previous version. So keeping that as kind of clean as possible, so that when you do need to dive through history, analyze where that bug came from, it's as obvious as possible. And you know, commits that go into a central repository together or into a published repository together, you know, we don't need to know you had a broken commit and you fixed it up with a fix me. Kind of, that's just noise. And it's also noise that might be harmful. So if you're doing a Git bisect and you've got some intermediate commits that don't even compile, but you know, they were never the tip of master, it's not important, it's not interesting, and it's also kind of not helpful to have them, you know, back in time at some point, which you might be able to hit with a bisect. Yes?
I see the tendency that version control systems are mainly made for computer scientists. We are used to writing a lot of code, so
yeah,
we are used to using a command line. But if you have other people in your team, like artists that make graphics, they have a lot of difficulty to get head around these version control systems.
That's true, and also artists tend to work with like really large files.
Yes, they do.
Yes, I suspect that as developers not economic programmers, do a poor service generally to people with slightly different needs. So yes, I mean there are other tools like, you know, document management systems that kind of address things in a different way. So yeah, maybe that's one of the ways in which version control systems need to improve is kind of definitely that. And all of those, so there are actually, it's kind of like two things that we've touched on there that are kind of important to that. So it's the large file handling and also the kind of that ease of use, that interface, so that maybe the myth that the command line is the best way to interact, maybe we need to kind of solve that as well. Yes.
Are there any, I'm a solo developer and I'm used to version. Are there any real advantages to switching to a distributed version control system? Bear in mind that I don't do my programming on a plane. You know, I'm just sitting there in an office across multiple machines. I found this version to be fine so far, but you know, I sort of feel like a lot of people look at me that it's one of the dark ages now to get a new one.
Well, I guess if you're a solo developer and you don't work on a plane, you kind of like, there are a lot of advantages that wouldn't matter to you. you've already got the subversion server set up that you're happy with, so like the user setup again doesn't kind of really apply to you at the moment. So yeah, I think if I was in your situation, you know, you have a tool that helps you get the job done, you don't have much concurrency, you've got a setup that works. Yeah, I mean, you're probably in a situation where about the least reason to move. I mean, if you were starting again now, you know, you might pick up Git and like it. But yeah, at the moment, probably not. I mean, maybe migration of the repository and backup store is slightly easier with Git, but I imagine you've got kind of a backup story. So, right. But lots of other people want to answer differently.
Subversion to Git, and it wasn't until I switched that I was glad that I had very good, because it was just a lot faster, even when you're on a local network. But also, you start branching, and you start making branches all the time, and suddenly you get the benefit of that, you didn't even realize you need it. And
I should be more militant, shouldn't I?
Yeah, I'd say experimentation is cheap.
Yeah.
Because branching is cheap, experimenting on a file and throwing it away, that also means.
Really found that to be a problem with subversion, though it's easy enough to just create a problem.
Yeah, I find branching a bit cheap.
So the thing I try to do is
expensive. In what way can you describe it as expensive?
Branching and subversion. Not that there's subversion, but I was thinking about the key difference. The value added distributed is the cheap branch.
Yeah.
So if you're branching cheap, you're fine.
Yeah.
See, that would be a
huge. Also, just throw away branches. You're not committed to things to put it on the servers and it run.
Just want to add that what you say about the right tool for the right problem. And I have a few projects at home where I still use CVS because it's a lot easier to set up. And for that project I'm alone, I don't need the branches. So
CVS is not easier to set up then?
Subversion.
Well, yeah, I don't know. I guess it took me a little while to get CDS set up. Anyway, we're over time, so thank you very much for your attention.